to Foothill. So glad to have you here this morning. It's a great weekend to be here. And before we keep singing, I want to focus our hearts and minds on why we're doing what we're doing this morning. We don't just come in here singing for no reason. The band and I were talking last night. This singing isn't a very common thing to do in a group. Unless you go to a concert or something, you're not just gathering with a bunch of people in the middle of the weekend singing. So this is kind of an unusual thing to do at a place, to just sing all together. But there's a great reason why we do this. We do this in response to a God who's given us his mercy. So Ephesians 2 just says it great. And it talks about, well, we were dead. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience. But this is good news, church. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. Amen? Amen, yeah. Say that together, church, together, by grace. Let's say it together. By grace you have been saved. Amen. He has saved us not of our own works, but through his son, Jesus Christ. Let's sing it. Not by our words, not by our thoughts, not by our deeds is grace received. It's a free gift for all. It's a free gift for all.
Let's declare that.
Sexuality and all the decisions that have been made about that, and you look on, you know, social media everywhere, and there's posts on both sides, just, you know, proclaiming victory, proclaiming defeat, or just hey, world is over, or this is the beginning of a new era, whatever it may be. As you flip through that, and then as I sing this song, I got a new perspective on what this song was talking about, and that look, at the end of the day, Christ has overcome. It is finished, he has won, and the battle has not been lost, or the battle has not been won in this one issue. And so I thought I'd just share that, and as we keep singing it, think with the culture in mind and where we are at. And at the end of the day, let the cross just stand above everything. And Lord, I want this church to be known for Jesus and the cross, what he has done for us. I want the church, this church and my life to be known for that Christ has already won. It is finished. It is done. And as we sing this song, we sing it with faith in our hearts, church. We sing it knowing that we have a God who is victorious. We sing it knowing we have a God who has already won the battle. And no matter what aisle the side you fall, that's not the issue. The issue is that Christ is supreme. Christ reigns above it all. So as we sing this, sing it with faith in your heart. Sing it knowing that Christ is the King. It is finished. It is done. Let's sing that phrase. The cross stands.
Yes, the cross stands above it all.
Yeah, just sing that line again. The cross stands. The cross stands above it all. Oh, we sing. Yes, the cross stands above it all.
Thank you for this time to sing, this time to worship you, to lift your name on high. And God, we thank you for the reminder that you and the work that you did on the cross does stand above everything, above every challenge, above every fear we have, and so we can fully rely on everything that you and your Son have done for our benefit. And so God, we pray that as we continue in this service, your Son will be magnified, Son will be glorified as we open up our word, as we continue in our series, Lord. And Lord, I pray that people would come to know you today because of what we study in the Song of Solomon. God, we love you and pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, hey, welcome to Foothill, guys. Welcome to Foothill Church. We're glad you're here. Adults, grab a seat. And kids, K through junior high age, go ahead and head out to the back. We have some great volunteers, great program for you today. Love to have you guys join us for Foothill students and Foothill kids this morning. And welcome to everyone else. We're glad you're here with us, and glad you're here at Foothill Church, especially if this is your first time. Hey, just by show of hands real fast, how many of you guys stayed up and did the whole fireworks in person, watch fireworks? You guys did that? Awesome. Who was asleep? Who was in bed? Me, I was. So either way, glad to have you guys here. Glad that you came out to Foothill this morning. And just a couple things for you. If this is your first time with us, I just want to say a special thank you for coming out. You're our VIP. We're glad you're here with us this morning. And if this is your first time, there's this orange and white connection card in the seat back in front of you. And if you have a minute during service, maybe while I'm talking right now, just pull it out for a minute, fill it out as completely as possible. We would love to know who you are a little bit, about your family, about how we can pray for you as a staff. In fact, this Monday coming up tomorrow, we actually have a staff prayer day. The staff takes once a month just to pray all day for the needs of the church, and we'd love to be able to pray for you. So make sure if you have any requests, make sure to fill that part out. But first time guests, we would love for you to stop by the Black Info Tent on the way out and make sure that you stop by and say hello. And if you hand them this card, we have a gift for you, just a way to say thank you for coming out. So make sure you do that on your way out this morning. We'd love for you to do that. I want to make one announcement this weekend. I want to make you aware of a weekend coming up. July 18th and 19th is our next baptism service. And so if you haven't been here for a baptism service before, it's one of our favorite weekends. It's a great opportunity for us to, as a church, to witness what God is doing, the real tangible fruit in people's lives spiritually. So here's what baptism is. If any of you aren't aware, baptism is simply an outward expression. It's an act of obedience that the Christian does as soon as they're saved. And it's a way for us to say, hey, this is to the whole world, to our family and friends. God's done something in my heart, and so I want to share that with you. So we have a tub, actually, that's kind of brought out right here. And during service, we'll bring people into the water, bring them back out as a reflection of their renewed life in Christ. And so if you've never been baptized before, if you're a Christian, if you've never been baptized, I want to encourage you to consider that for this weekend, July 18th and 19th. And here's how you can kind of get the process started. back to this connection card right there on the orange section that says, I'm interested in baptism. Just check that box, drop it in the bucket when it passes by, hand it to me, hand it to a staff member. We'd love to be able to get you in that process started and get baptized that weekend. It's a great weekend. So hopefully you guys, even if you're not getting baptized, you'll join us for that weekend just to celebrate what God's done in the lives of the people in our church. All right. I want to ask the ushers just to prepare for our time of offering this morning. For you as well, if you want to prepare for that. And while you do that, I just want to share a story that I read about. And I think, and maybe some of you guys notice this too, our society, our culture is oftentimes pretty obsessed with numbers and lists. So whether it's maybe, the top 10 billionaires in the world, or maybe it's the consumer price index or the coaches poll for what football team is going to be best this fall or whatever that is. And a lot of times we get kind of obsessed with these numbers. I came across this article that talked about a number that I'd never heard before. It was called the Misery Index. Now, maybe some of you guys have heard this before, a Misery Index. And the Misery Index is basically a number that represents all the bad things that are happening in the world. So you got pollution, you got lack of rain for us in California, you got unemployment, you got homicides, and all those numbers get kind of put into one number called the Misery Index. Now, at the risk of kind of just bumming everybody out this morning, this past year was our highest ever number on the Misery Index. It was like 12.6, which means nothing to you, I realize that. But it was basically kind of a rough year when it came to bad things. And here's the thing, a couple of observations about that number. First of all, I think it's interesting that a number like that exists. It is a way to kind of measure how sad people are and how bad things are going. But secondly, as Christians, as we think about what causes people to be either sad or happy, I think it kind of brings us back to our focus on eternal things, right? I mean, we can think all day and be sad and be upset about the things that are happening in the world, and not saying those things are unimportant, because they're very important, and God calls us to certain things when it comes to how we treat our world. But at the same time, how much are we affected? How is our joy impacted by things that are not eternal? And it makes me think about things like generosity. I think generosity is one of these perspective-shifting type of words that when you understand generosity, it really changes the way that you see the world. And things like the Misery Index, or things like unemployment, they're things that bother us, but they're not things that steal our joy. And so I want to encourage you, as you think about how God has been good to you, and how we now have the opportunity to invest in things that will last forever, not just temporary things, but last forever. Now, that's what offering is about. And that's what we have the opportunity to do every single week, is as a church, partner together as a community to make an impact for Christ in our community. So that's what we're doing as far as offering goes. I'll encourage you to remember that as we give this weekend. And if you've never given before, a couple of ways to do that. There's an offering envelope in the seat back in front of you. You can start there if you want to, drop cash or check in, or you can even put your card number on there and start giving that way. You can go online at foothillchurch.net/give and find more information about there on that site. And then you can give the easiest way, 45777, just text that number, and you can start giving that way. But as we think about how God has been generous to us, let's be generous back to him and worship him through this time of offering. Would you bow your heads with me? Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. And even today, just waking up and living in a country that provides us freedom, Lord, freedom to gather here and to worship you, God. We're grateful that we have the opportunity to experience that together. And so, Lord, we on this morning, this opportunity to worship you, God, we don't take that for granted. We realize this is a great opportunity. Even in our giving, our financial commitment, Lord, we worship you through this act of giving, God. And Lord, I pray that as the money comes in this weekend, that the church leaders, we'd be faithful, we'd be wise stewards of the money that comes in, so that it's best used for your kingdom and its purposes. Lord, we love you and pray this in your name. Amen.
Good morning, Foothill Church. My name is Ebenezer, and I have been attending Foothill Church for the past 4 years, my family and I, and this is such a great church. We don't want to be anywhere else, but so today is a very beautiful day and a great time to commemorate the freedom, you know, in the 17th of America, and for such a beautiful country that opens its doors to everybody from around the world, people like me who comes from Ghana, from Africa, and get to be accepted and received amongst you. Every time I listen to your national anthem, I burst to tears because that last part always gets me. The home, the land of the free, and the home of the brave. Even though sometimes I think our their freedom is so much that it has imprisoned us. But praise God for this land, and I want to spend a few minutes to just pray that God's presence will not leave this nation. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for the United States of America and for the opportunity for us to celebrate freedom and to remember July 4th. We pray, oh Lord, and ask for one thing, that, Lord, your presence will not leave this nation, that your presence will continue to be with us. And just like we say, in you we trust, we will continue to trust you. And even as we go into the subject of Songs of Solomon, talking about a marriage bed today, we pray, oh Lord, that you will open our eyes that we might behold the wondrous things in your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so this is it. Last week, Pastor Stephen talked about the wedding weekend, and the honeymoon is beginning today. And so today we're going to be talking about the marriage bed. Can I ask you to do me a favor? Two things. Number one, for those of you who are married, come with me on a journey down memory lane and recall two things. One, how did you feel right after your wedding? Right after your wedding, how did you feel, and what was exactly in your mind? What were you thinking? Now, if you are single, you can still come on this journey, but not down memory lane, because there's no memory to go for. I need you to go up fantasy lane and think about what you would want to feel right after your wedding and what you would want to be thinking about. Now, I don't know about you, but as for me, after 30 years of hearing, don't do it, don't touch it, don't do it, don't touch it, on that fateful Saturday afternoon of September 4th, 2004, I remember it very well, and my wife is sitting right here. There was just one thing in my mind. I'm like, you know what? We've made it, so let's go have some fun. I felt qualified to explore this great subject and phenomenon of sexual intimacy. And this was supposed to bring a couple joy and bring glorification to God. Now, I won't lie to you. At that particular moment, the God glorification part was really not part of my thinking. I just want to go check this out. And I did. And you ask me how it was, I'll tell you, I felt like, man, I can get used to this. And at that moment, I understood why they kept telling me, don't do it, don't touch it, because it's like an infectious disease that takes over your whole body, your whole mind, your whole thinking, that has no cure. It's like an addiction that takes you over the entire aspect of your life. Now, I know my experience may not be exactly your experience, okay? But one thing we can all agree on is that all of us comes to this phenomenon of sexual intimacy with different levels of understanding, different levels of expectation, and since I'm an HR practitioner, with different levels of previous experience. So chances are that since we are humans, we mess it up. Just like any gift that God gives us. And you ask, why is that? And that's simple, because we are descendants of Adam and Eve, remember? We specialize in messing things up. Friends, it is therefore not a hidden fact that we have messed up sexual intimacy so much that research available in the Marriage and Family Journal says that flawed sexual intimacy is part of the top five reasons why couples aren't happy in marriages today. And the same flawed sexual intimacy is listed among the first top 10 reasons why couples divorce. What about sexual intimacy that causes people unhappiness? And they consider breaking their vows over that. It is therefore very comforting to me, and maybe to you, that God is not just interested in redeeming us for heaven, but he's also interested in redeeming sexual intimacy for the marriage bed. Because in its fullest, best state, it brings exceeding joy to the couple, as well as reflects the purest love that Christ has for you and I when we come to him. So today we'll be exploring Songs of Solomon chapter 4 verse 1 through to chapter 5 verse 1. And we shall attempt to discern the activities God actually desires to take place in the marriage bed when husband and wife, as defined by this, not by the Supreme Court, as defined by this, are in there alone with God as the unseen but invited guest. Now, to put it all together in one sentence, I would say, Songs of Solomon chapter 4 verse 1 to chapter 5 verse 1 is saying, the marriage bed where sexual intimacy is meant to take place must be kept pure. And that is the only way that it will bring joy to the couple and reflect the purity of Christ's love for the church. This is worth repeating. The marriage bed where sexual intimacy is meant to take place must be kept pure. And that is the only way it will bring joy to the couple and reflect the purity of Christ's love for his church. In other words, the pleasure, the protection, the oneness that sexual intimacy has in store for a husband and wife can only be realized when sexual intimacy is enjoyed in a pure marriage bed. It is then and only then that their relationship will reflect Christ's love. So you may ask, you keep mentioning marriage bed, marriage bed, marriage bed. Is this some kind of special bed that's sold in some kind of special departmental store which I can go and buy? Actually, no. It is a metaphor which is used to describe the consummated sexual union between a husband and a wife. And here again, as defined by Scripture. Now, so the question is, what does a pure marriage bed look like? What activities does God desire to take place in the marriage bed? The Scripture we have in front of us today, we can glean four broad activities from Songs of Solomon chapter 4 verse 1 to chapter 5 verse 1. That God desires to take place in the marriage bed. So let's take them one by one. Are you ready? Yeah. Let's go get it. Now, the first one is express your love for your mate. God expects that there is love expression in the marriage bed. Last week we heard about the wedding, like I already said. Now the wedding is over, and the couple are ready to consummate their marriage. But before then, and that takes place in verse 16, but before then, there is a series of exchanges between husband and wife expressing love for each other. So let's now look at Scripture and see how the husband, the bridegroom, expressed his love for his bride. And as a summary before we go in, we could say he blessed his wife with his words. He blessed his wife with his words. It is a public secret, but let me let you in on this. Already you know, but women are created as verbal creatures. And Solomon knew this. So he scratched her where she itched. He went ahead and generously blessed her with genuine words of love. Let's go into it. Songs of Solomon chapter 4, if you have the Bibles in front of you, is on page 561. Let's read from verse 1 and then verse 7. It says, "Behold, you are beautiful, my love. Behold, you are beautiful." And then it goes on to verse 7, where it talks about, "You are altogether beautiful, my love. There is no flaw in you." And all through chapter 4, verse 1 to 7, he calls her his love all through. He tells her she is altogether beautiful, meaning she is completely, thoroughly, totally, and absolutely beautiful. Here we see that the husband sees the wife as his standard of beauty. The same way, guys, we are not to compare anything or anyone to our wives. They are our standard of beauty. And this is where, among many things that happen to us men, especially in America, pornography is a menace. Because you go watch it, there are stories of men, you know, being in bed with their husbands, with their wives, and they are mentioning other women's names. Even when they don't mention those names, they are in bed with their spouses and their mind is somewhere else. Because they don't get what they want, as they have seen in those pictures or in those videos or in those extramarital relationships, they are not satisfied with what they get from their spouses. Scripture says, your wife is your standard. Friends, and husbands specifically, how do you express your love to your wife in the marriage bed? I used to think that it's only African men who, because of our upbringing, every iota of emotion has been extracted out of us. And so we don't know how to express our emotions. You are supposed to be tough. You are supposed to be hard to the point where you can kill lions and protect your family, but not anymore. I've been to Asia, I've been to the Middle East, I've been to Europe, I've been to America, and we men, we are all the same. We are all descendants of Adam, and we don't particularly do well with the expression of emotions. But the good news is we can learn it, because a godly husband will bless his wife with his words. He will remember that love is a beautiful four-letter word, which is sometimes spelled time and sometimes spelled talk. And men, husbands, when you say it, mean it, because our wives have a special gift from God. They know when you don't mean it. You know, and I say, don't say it like you mean it. No. Say it because you mean it. And maybe some of you seated here are looking at me, they're like, Ebi, you don't get it. You have no idea how hard it is to love this woman in my house. It's a pain in the neck, and I can't handle it. Well, to that I say, go back home today after church, sit down and ask Jesus how easy it is for him to love and forgive your jacked up life every day. And when Jesus tells you, he says, love your wife the same way he loves you. How do you express love for your wives? Now let's turn to the bride. How did she express her love for her husband? And the scripture tells us that she blesses her husband with her body. Now, ladies, let me let you in on another public secret worth mentioning. That women, we are moved by what we see. This is our problem right here, these two things here. We are visual. And so the bride was sure to come into the marriage bed with such a body radiating of physical beauty and great beauty that the husband could not resist it, but burst into verbal praise unto her. In fact, the bride was so generous in blessing her husband with her body that the bridegroom, the husband, noticed it and specifically praised 8 parts of her body. He noticed it. He saw it. So let's take it one by one. Songs of Solomon chapter 4 verse 1. She prepared her eyes and her hair specifically for her husband. And let's read it. He said, "Your eyes are doves behind your veil." He could see the eye. He could see the peace and tranquility within the eye as a result of the blessing of the words that was given to the bride. And you can tell, if you've been married for some time, that you just need to look into her eye to know whether she believes you or not. She doesn't have to say it. Their eyes give them away. And then she talks about the hair. "Your hair is like a flock of goats leaping down the slopes of Gilead." He goes ahead. The lady prepared the hair so beautifully. And for some of you who only see beef, meat, chicken, only in Albertsons or in Trader Joe's or in Stater Brothers, but have actually not seen a real goat and you have to travel before you go see them, I lived and grew up in the village. And here is the picture being painted. Normally, if you live in a very hot climate, grass doesn't grow very well on the footsteps or in the valleys when the weather is hot. But in the mountainside where the temperature is cooler, grass grows there. So you herd the goat and the sheep and the cow up the mountain, they graze, and then in the evening, they come back. And for this guy whose world has been very agricultural, he stands down, sees the goat come down from the Gilead Mountain. It's such a beautiful sight for him. So for him to use it as a compliment to praise the wife's hair is such a great compliment. Beautiful. And for us who are men also, we realize that also indicates that the lady has let down her hair in readiness to give herself to her husband. And if you know that long enough as a man, you know that is your green light, isn't it? Now, we go to verse 2 and 3. He praises her teeth, her lips, her mouth, and her cheeks. Let's explore it. "Your teeth are like a flock of shorn ewes that have come up from washing, all of which bear twins, not one among them is lost." Which kind of clearly shows how clean, how bright, and how white the teeth were. "Your lips are like a scarlet thread, and your mouth is lovely. Her lips are lovely, her breath is fresh, and her words are very enticing to her husband." He goes on to praise the cheeks and say, "Your cheeks are like halves of a pomegranate behind your veil." Why pomegranate? Because it's aesthetically beautiful, the color is very nice, it is tasteful, and in the Far East and in many parts of the world, they see pomegranate as having aphrodisiac qualities. So what's going on there? For him to use pomegranate to describe the cheeks of his wife, what's going on there is like just by the sight of the cheeks of the wife, he gets kicked on. He enjoys it, right? And then you go on to chapter 4, verse 4, he praises her neck. And so your neck is like a Tower of David built in rows of stones, it hands of thousands of shields, all of them shields of warriors. Now, who, after being shielded and praised with such beautiful, honest words of love, will not stand tall in front of her bride, of her bridegroom, of her husband? So she stands tall, being inspired by the words of love healed on her by her husband. chapter 4, verse 5, talks about her breasts. She says, your two breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle, that gaze among the lilies. They look soft, they look tender, they look delicate, they look attractive to him. Chapter 4, verse 6, and all the way to chapter 4, verse 7 says, until the day breaches and the shadows flee, I will go away to the mountain of myrrh and the hill of frankincense. There he praises her entire body and how she carefully perfumed herself and smelled so sweet walking into the marriage bed. And then in verse 7, he says, you are altogether beautiful, my love. There is no flaw in you. Summarizing how beautiful and how sincere he looks at the beauty of the bride. The bride so carefully and intentionally prepared herself in blessing her husband, and her husband noticed it. So husbands, do you notice it when your wives carefully and intentionally prepare themselves for the marriage bed? Wives, do you express your love for your husbands, and how do you do it in the bedroom? Do you approach the marriage bed haphazardly, like we say in Ghana? Do you approach the marriage bed anyhowly? Do you just go in there very carelessly? Now, wives, when you hear how the husband has described his wife in Songs of Solomon, what do you hear? Do you hear only physical beauty? Just so we are clear, and Pastor Chris does not get emails of husbands complaining that wives have broken their family budget for looking beauty in the name of looking beautiful for them in the bed. Let's hear what 1 Peter has to say. He says, your beauty should not come from outward adornment, such as elaborate hairstyles and the wearing of gold jewelry or fine clothes. Rather, it should be that of your inner self, the unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is of great worth in God's sight. What I don't hear 1 Peter saying is, don't look good. Don't dress up. Don't make your hair look wretched. No, that is not what I hear 1 Peter saying. But the question I think is, where do you put the emphasis of your beauty? Is it within or without? I think there is a difference between perceiving your beauty from coming from within or perceiving it from coming from without. Where you put your emphasis makes a huge difference. There sure is something about the person within that makes the body more beautiful. Wives, let the beauty of the bodies you bless your husbands with reflect the internal and unfading beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit. Let's move on to the number two broad category of activities. Express your desire for your mate. So now they have expressed love to each other in the room. The passion pressure is rising in the bedroom. And you will notice that with the increase in passion, the husband's emphasis when addressing the bride changes from your to mine. And let us read it and look at it from chapter 4, verse 11. It says, chapter 4, verse 10. It says, how beautiful is your love, my sister, my bride? How much better is your love than wine? And then you come to chapter 4, verse 12. It says, a garden locked is my sister, my bride. A spring locked, a fountain sealed. And then you jump down and go to verse 16b. He said, let my beloved come to his garden and eat his choicest fruits. And you look at verse 1 of chapter 5. I came to my garden, my sister, my bride. I gathered my myrrh, my spice. I ate my honeycomb with my honey. I drank my wine and my milk. The emphasis shows clearly that some form of reality has dawned on this gentleman, that the lady he is beholding is now his to have and to hold, to love and to serve and to honor and treat well. It also indicates the fact that his attention is zoomed on the wife, not anywhere else. And rightly so, because in biblical intimacy and sex, you will always be focused on your mate before you look to yourself. The husband will demonstrate this in two parts. And in the first part, in verse 8, he will invite the wife and he says, "Come with me from Lebanon, my bride. Come with me from Lebanon. Depart from the peak of Amana, from the peak of Senir and Hermon, from the dens of lions, from the mountains of leopard." The husband invites her to his safe haven of care, protection, and love, because now she is his love, she is his bride. And talking about leopards and lions kind of signify the insecurities and the fears that the bride will be having at that moment. They said, "Leave those stuff. Come to my protection. Come to my love and to my care." The underlying principle here is this, that the marriage bed is not a place of selfishness. In intimacy, make it all about your spouse. So for our intimacy expectations and invitations to receive a warm welcome and reception, they must be clothed in genuine words of safety and security that is at the focus. Husbands and wives, do you express intimacy desires with the need of your spouse in mind? Or do you express them selfishly? From verse 9 to 11, he then demonstrates how captivated his heart has been by the bride. And verse 9, he says, "You have captivated my heart, my sister, my bride. You have captivated my heart with one glance of your eyes, with one jewel of your neck." The heart, because that is the center of emotion and the being. In my culture, if I were writing this in my cultural language, I would have said deliver. Instead of saying, "You captivated my heart," I would have said, "With one glance of your eyes, you make my liver quiver." Because the center of emotion in my culture is the liver. But he says, "You've captured my heart, my bride." And he also says, "My sister." What's going on here? Is there something weird going on? Are they committing incest or something? Actually, no. The term sister was used here figuratively to refer to the friendship and affection of bond that remains between the husband and the wife. So it's not his sister, but she is his sister. Now, he would go on to elaborate on this captivation in verse 10, where he says, "How beautiful is your love, my sister, my bride. How much better is your love than wine, and the fragrance of your oils than any spice." That indicates to you that this guy is getting to the point of intoxication by the wife's love, and he realizes that it's actually much better than wine, because it does not make you go crazy. It does not make you walk roughly and you fall down, but he is still standing, he's thinking straight, but he's enjoying and feeling intoxicated by the wife's love. And also, he talks about the fragrances and the oils on her, which signifies just how sweet-smelling the lady is as they behold each other in the room. Then in chapter 4, verse 11, he talks about, "Your lips drip nectar, my bride. Honey and milk are under your tongue. The fragrance of your garment is like the fragrance of Lebanon." How often do you kiss when you are in the bedroom? Solomon has found joy in deep and long wet kisses with his bride. He enjoys it. He feels it. And he smells the aroma within the room, within her clothes and everything. How much of a captive are you to your spouse? How badly do you desire him or her? And do you keep that feeling inside you, or you express it? Let's go to the third one. Express your availability for your mate. And we all know one of the greatest gifts we can ever give to each other in marriage is exclusive and exciting sex. Exclusive because we are supposed to only be available to our spouses. In fact, that we have already seen that that is the only way we get joy as married couples, as well as reflecting Christ's love for the church. And the Bible is crystal clear on what we need to do when it comes to sexual immorality. He says, flee from it. He didn't say walk from it. He didn't say run from it. He didn't say crawl from it. What did he say? Flee from it. In all of its forms, premarital, extramarital, or natural. In fact, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 18 says, flee from sexual immorality. Every other sin a man commits is outside the body. But the sexually immoral person sins against his whole body. If you are single, let me bear you a little testimony. And I don't mean this to be wrongly taken or saying as though I am boasting. No, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Without God, that wouldn't have happened. But I think that one of the best decisions that I have made, or better still, being forced to make before I got married, was to wait and meet my wife and marry before I have sex. And because of that, even if other things are there to distract me and the possibility of me sinning is there, at least now that I am married, I have no one to compare her to. And so if you've not lost your virginity yet, I encourage you, hold on to it. Keep it. That is the best gift you ever give to your spouse. If you've lost it, all hope is not lost. Hold on, save it right now, and begin it again when you get into marriage. And if none of this encourages you, let's go back into Scripture and see how Solomon praised his bride and see if that can encourage you. You look at chapter 4, verse 12. Solomon said, a garden locked is my sister, my bride. A spring locked, a fountain sealed. This is such a beautiful imagery for the bride's purity and virginity. She is locked, sealed, and saved. She has locked, sealed, and saved herself for her husband, the only one she belongs to. If you're single, always remember that you must and can only be available sexually in marriage and to your spouse. For us who are married folks, this is an exhortation for us to stay faithful in our marriages. There are records of how damaging extramarital affairs could be to a family. We must be available and accessible sexually only to our spouses. That is what it means to keep the marriage bed pure. And the Bible says in Hebrews 13:4, marriage should be honored amongst all, and the marriage bed kept pure. And listen to this carefully. This is not AB saying it. This is Hebrews saying it. For God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. If that does not scare you enough, the Bible says it is more fearful to fall into the hands of God than to break his law. Husbands, let your availability be only for your wives. Wives, let your availability be only to your husbands. It pleases God when the marriage bed is kept pure. Otherwise, according to the Bible, you will be judged. The bridegroom now extends his imagery describing the exoticness of her garden, which is his bride. And he says, your shoots are like an orchard of pomegranates. Again, pomegranate is here, with all choicest fruits. heather with nard, nard and saffron, calamus and cinnamon, with all trees of frankincense, myrrh and aloes, with all choice spices, a garden fountain, a well of living water, and a flowing stream from Lebanon. What is going on here? For those of you who have a little bit of agricultural knowledge, you will understand that all these plants and trees that have been mentioned here cannot grow in one climate. Some in a temperate climate, some in a tropical climate, but in his bride, he finds all the variety. What does that mean for sexual intimacy? The marriage bed is not supposed to be boring. It's supposed to be exciting. It's supposed to be, every session is meant to be an adventure, to be reminisced and enjoyed and savored and enjoyed. Friends, the couple will holistically satisfy each other to the point where there will be no boredom in the marriage bedroom. The bridegroom also thinks of his bride as a garden fountain, a well of flowing water in verse 15. To other men, she is perpetually and forever locked. But to her husband, she is perpetually opened. In fact, she could cause a tsunami to her husband. The same should be said about us men. And let me put it in words we can understand. Men, your zips are permanently zipped, your belts are permanently buckled, and the only person on earth who has the combination code is your wife. No one else. To her, it is widely open, it's perpetually open. So the question to you today is, are you single? Save yourself for marriage. Are you married? Keep the marriage bed pure. The last broad activity is express your satisfaction in your mate. From the beginning of Songs of Solomon, we have heard the bride tell the bridegroom, hold on, don't awaken love, what is not yet is time. Save it, don't do it, like I kept hearing for 30 years. But now, the couple have become a husband and a wife, and they have expressed their love, desire, and availability for each other, and it is time for them to express their satisfaction in each other. And for the first time in this section, the bride speaks in chapter 4, verse 16b, says, let my beloved come to his garden and eat its choicest fruits. She speaks now to the bridegroom as if saying, I am the one who said it was not time. I'm the one who says, hold on. But now, here I am, fair and square. You can take me now. I'm ready for you. Now, it's as though she has picked up from her husband's imagery of the garden and beckons him into his garden, and she tells him how she is feeling and what she wants. She says, come and eat of your garden and of your garden's choicest fruits. Now, he comes in, he eats what is rightfully given to him, and that for which he has so patiently and selflessly worked hard. And in chapter 5, verse 1, we have a report of the consummation. He says, I came to my garden, my sister, my bride. I gathered my myrrh with my spice. I ate my honeycomb with my honey. I drank my wine with my milk. The account of the husband after their sexual consummation is not disappointing at all. The account is a great testimony of how rewarding the wait, the patience, and going about it the right way could be. Note, however, that in this verse, he did not just come into the garden, enjoy the garden, and walk away. He ensured that he told her how wonderful it has been. In fact, in my culture, we say, he who eats and never thanks the cook is not well brought up. She invited him in. He honored the invitation. He showed up, and then he expressed in the most beautiful way how satisfied he was. Husbands, Do you walk into the garden, eat your honey, eat your milk, drink from your honeycomb, and just walk away? We should not do that. Let's learn from Solomon. Wives, do you tell your husband how wonderful the session has been? So how does all of it and all of this we have talked about as activities that take place in a marriage bed exalt Jesus Christ? We have seen how the bride's husband views her as perfect, flawless, with no imperfection. He sees the bride as altogether beautiful. That is how Jesus sees us. Regardless of the bride's low self-esteem, insecurities about herself, the bridegroom showers her with his true love. If you are Christian, that is what Jesus did and does for you and I on a daily basis. He substituted himself in your and my place and imputed his righteousness over us. And regardless of our brokenness and our jacked-upness, he loves us. This is the kind of love our marriages are supposed to reflect. Husbands, the Bible says, love your wives as Christ loves the church. If you don't know Jesus, this is the kind of love that awaits you. He loves you no matter what. Regardless of what you think you have done, regardless of how unacceptable you think your life and act has been, Jesus loves you anyway. He's knocking at your door right now. And he says, if you open it, I will come in and I will shower you with love regardless. Would you open the door to your heart for Jesus today? Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the opportunity for us to share and to hear what you desire to take place in the marriage bed. Help us, O God, that we will live by your word. In Jesus' name, amen. So what we talked about of those who may not have known Jesus and talked about the love that awaits you, if that is you, the card which Pastor Stephen talked about at the beginning of the service, take it. Fill it in at the end. We'd like to be a great resource to you. If you're here, you're already Christian, and you've heard things that have convicted your heart, may the Lord be with you as we seek to work for changes in our lives. The band will sing for us whilst communion will go on. That is a fellowship where we break bread and we break and drink off Jesus' blood and his body. If you're Christian, you're a brother, you're a sister, enjoy it. And in the end, the worship team will just lead us in worship songs whilst we close. Thank you for coming.
Sinners, Jesus, lover of my soul. Friends may fail me, foes assail me. He, my Savior, makes me whole. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, what a friend. Saving, helping, keeping, loving. With me to the end. Yes. Jesus, what a strength in weakness. Let me hide myself. Tried and sometimes failing, he, my strength, my victory wins. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, what
communion. You can stand to your feet. We're going to continue singing about Jesus Christ and his word, remembering what he did for us. We'll sing about it this morning.
And no words can describe the glorious scene of love hanging down, bleeding for me. And no song can suffice for singing your praise, for you gave your son. There's freedom for me.
Church, to make this your prayer. As we've heard the word of God preached to us this morning, there's always ways in which it speaks to us, in which we can, God would change our hearts and our lives. Let's make this our prayer. The words say, I give you my life, I give you my trust. Let's sing it out together.
I give you my life, I give you my trust, Jesus. You are my God, never enough, Jesus.
Amen. One more time, church. I give you my life.
I give you my life. I give you my trust, Jesus. For you are
on his name, Jesus.
Jesus.
Let's lift our hands, church, and declare this.
My heart is.
Declare this.
My heart is.
Offer him your life.
Take it all. Take it all. My life in your hands. My heart. Take up my cross, yeah. Jesus.
declare this before we leave. My heart is yours. My heart is yours. Take it all. Take it all. My life in your hands. One more time. My heart is yours. My heart is yours. Take it all. Take it all. My life in your hands.
Amen. Amen. Well, it's great to worship you guys this morning. And as you go, I just want to encourage you, if you made a decision to follow Christ today, we'd love to know about that and take that connection card. Go out to the Black Info Tent. There's people that would love to pray for you. If any of you need prayer this morning, there's some folks that will be up here to pray for any needs. And we'd love to be able to do that together. Let's bow our heads as we close out. Lord, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for your son, Jesus, and for all that he's done for us too, to stand in the gap for us so that we would be righteous in your eyes. And so God, I pray that as we go from here, that the word we heard would be planted deeply into our hearts, that it would change our marriages, it would change our relationships, and most of all, God, it would change our relationship with you for the better. So go with us, Lord, as we leave. We thank you for this church. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, guys, I'll see you next week. Happy 4th of July weekend.